Amazing, sir. Amazing bounty. And I suppose the older you get, the dimmer the late memories come and the sharper the early ones. Fairfield School at Basingstoke, it's a great heap of red brick. The council school my father went to soon after it was opened in the last century is right next to the cricket ground, May's Bounty. But in the First World War, of course, there was no cricket going on there. There were troops stationed there. And the soldiers didn't come back from that war right on the end of hostilities. Many of them didn't come back for a year and a half afterwards. And in 1919, there was no cricket played there at all. In 1920, a little fat boy went to that school, 6 years old, was fascinated to see men in white clothes out there. They were only in the nets, of course, bowling and batting, and I suppose that did it. There were four of us, and we used to go out there at every possible moment. The pro, old Bert Butler, sometimes used to shoo us away when we were a nuisance, but soon he came to realise that we were hooked. We were gone on this game, and he was desperately good to us because we weren't members, we didn't pay subscriptions. We used to field out and he'd let us have a bit of practice afterwards, but that was later, of course. It was 1921, that was the great year. England were murdered by Australia. But Hampshire had a great season. They were sixth in the county championship. They'd only once been higher than that. And Mead and Brown and Tennyson and all of Hampshire were the heroes of that routed English team. They came straight from their last match that they won to make them sixth in the table. They came to play Basingstoke on May's Bounty. And it's difficult to say just what that did to two or three of us. Philip Mead, he completed 2,000 runs for the season. 3,000 was it? Whatever it was. His usual vast number just the day before. And then Lionel Tennyson came in. Basingstoke had batted, Alec Kennedy had bowled him out, coming on late to let him get a few runs. And Lionel Tennyson, that huge, hefty man with the great big briar pipe and the shapeless trilby hat and the swaggering approach, the misplaced Georgian, came out and he hit 152. They'd long passed the Hampshire total. Nobody cared, he went on. And even for a little boy, there was one stroke. He hit it on the up, as they'd say nowadays. And the straight boundaries were short on May's Bounty, and that skimmed over the sight screen down at the town end. And it went on and up and across Bounty Road and over Mayor's Garden. Nobody tried to get it, they just called for another ball. And then he hit one straight from the other end. Looking over the fence, you saw a little boy running up Castle Field football ground beyond, and running and running and running, as if this thing had gone for miles and miles and miles before he caught it. And there was one savage hook that went into the allotments. Ah, and a spanking cover drive that went up to the pavilion. All this was magic and something desperately new. And this, after all, was the captain of England. And afterwards, unknown in Basingstoke, they had a chain of electric lights round the ground and the Northants Ironworks band played in their lovely blue uniforms, and people danced on the cricket pitch, and Basingstoke had never known a day or a night like it, and it had made one convert to cricket forever. But of course, in those days, if you lived in the north of the county, Southampton was a long, long way away, and only Bert Gibbons from the north of the county in that time ever played for Hampshire. It was as if there was a wall at Eastleigh and nobody came north of it, and he didn't talk lightly of railway fares to Southampton and the salaries of those days. And then in 1926, up to Uncle Frank's flat in London, a holiday without having to pay the rent, they came down and lived in our house. And on that Saturday, to go to the Oval, all the warnings, there were going to be such crowds there, nobody would ever get in. 12 years old, but off down to the Oval on the tram from Victoria. The sandwiches all eaten by 12:15, of course, to see Jack Hobbs and Herbert Sutcliffe. They didn't make so many in the first innings. The big stand was in the second, and I've for years conned myself that I saw that, and of course I didn't. I only saw the first day. And I saw Jack Hobbs bowled out by a full toss from Arthur Maley. The important thing about that was they both laughed, which I suppose would never happen nowadays. And from then on, the dedication was complete. There was no way out of this. The next year, a holiday with grandmother down at Eastbourne. And 1927, Lancashire came to play Sussex, virtually certain of winning the championship. And by what seemed a cricketing miracle, Sussex beat them. Not only beat them, they beat them by an innings. And lying down under the sight screen, this was a revelation, to watch the ball from Maurice Tate disappear, appear again, and then pitch and disappear the other way, because he was swinging it through the air and it was angling off the seam. And this seemed a quite bewildering magic. And they bowled out Lancashire for 99. Maurice Tate and Tishy Brown, the schoolmaster from Meads, who bowled off the wrong leg, the Reverend F.B.R. Brown, and my grandmother always said would come to a bad end because he shot a cuckoo that annoyed him by cuckooing in his garden. And then Holdsworth and Gilligan got hundreds, and Sussex made 371. And then, and this was the great Lancashire side of Charlie Hallows and Frank Watts and Ernest Dilsley, Harry Makepeace, wonderful old Shake, Jack Eden, Frank Sibbles, and Ted MacDonald, that vivid Australian fast bowler. But anyway, Sussex bowled about 76, I think it was, and then, how spoilt can you get? It was like a royal reception. The crowd swept onto the ground and called for speeches after this famous victory. And Green, Captain Green, the Lancashire captain, came on to the pavilion balcony. It looked as if his side had lost the championship, and he made a speech of such grace and generosity about the wonderful way Sussex had played. And then, of course, Nottinghamshire only had to avoid defeat by Glamorgan in the last match of the season, and Glamorgan hadn't won a match all the year, and Glamorgan incredibly beat him, and Lancashire after all got the championship. And this, to a rather innocent little boy, looked like the reward of virtue for Green's generosity and that terribly noble speech. Well, I suppose if you lived in a big town you saw lots of cricket, it became pretty commonplace. But if you were down to about one match a season, well, you had to pick pretty carefully. In 1928, the West Indies came, and everybody was terribly thrilled, reading the papers, about this man Constantine having won the game against Middlesex almost off his own bat. So that was the game we had to see. And somehow or other, we had to get there. George Alexander, the local undertaker, said he'd take us down if we were down at his workshop at 7:30 in the morning. And if we didn't mind travelling with a coffin, we wouldn't have minded travelling with 10 coffins. Down we went, and then, oh dear, George Brown, Alec Kennedy, Ronnie Aird, even Philip Mead, all out, and Constantine had taken 4 for 24, that bounding, exciting athlete. And this was as if a miracle had happened. He was wonderful. And then Lionel Tennyson, it had to be Lionel Tennyson again, came into Jack Newman, dear, kindly, gentle Jack, the gambling bachelor, gambled his benefit money away and another £300 before he ever drew benefit money. And that after he'd been nearly £1,000 up on the flat racing season in June. Jack Newman and Lionel Tennyson got together, and Lionel, now, he was a sucker for spinners. They only had to toss it in the air and he was gone. But this West Indies side had no really appreciable spinner. He took 200 of them. He simply hit like a whirlwind, and Griffith bounced one at his head. Suddenly this great fat, and he spun on one foot and he hooked it right down over where the Speedway Stadium was later to be, right down in the long leg corner, and it seemed as if it would never come down. He positively hit it on its way and added speed to a fast bouncer. It was rather lucky because he did a bit of trouble with the coffin and he decided to come down the next day, so we saw 2 days. And if you say that deaths are providential, that's not often true, but that one was. So by now, 3 great matches, the Test of 1926, the Sussex-Lancashire game of 27, Hampshire-West Indies 1928, and now it was like a drug, it was compulsive. And then starting to earn a living, a pretty meagre one as an office boy. But nevertheless, you could save up a bit of money and go to London, stay in a pretty poor Russell Square boarding house and go to cricket during the day and theatre during the evening. And a pair of us set off for Leighton, a prodigious distance. Strange ground that was, with all those out grey ammunition boxes and a man who used to go around saying, "Who says a nice house walls these?" It took us about 2 hours to translate that meant "who says a nice ice walls." And anyway, the journey to Leighton on a bus was a revelation to a country boy. Miles and miles and miles of bricks and mortar. And that recalls one of cricket's great funny stories. In 1925, now you can put down the date because it was the year that Alf Jeacock came back to play for Surrey. He'd been stopped 3 years earlier from playing by Kent, and Kent meant Lord Harris. Harris, of course, was the autocrat of cricket for the best part of 50 years. Didn't always get away with everything. Once he was invited to Royal Ascot, where, of course, protocol was pretty strict, and they had the cutaway coats and the sponge bag trousers and the toppers. And Harris arrived in one of those square brown bowler hats and a dog-tooth tweed. Edward VII looked at him with a certain amount of mild interest and said, "Where are you going, Harris? Ratting?" But he nipped that down to rule cricket with a rod of iron, and he got Alf Jeacock stopped from playing for Surrey because, although the road where he lived was Surrey on one side, it was Kent on the other, and he lived on the Kent side, and Lord Harris put him out again. But anyway, this was the year Alf Jeacock came back, and Surrey were playing Essex at Leighton. And Percy George Fender and Johnny Douglas, the respective captains, were not on very good terms. There'd been a bit of a niggle because Fender didn't want to conform about the Essex change of lunchtimes. So it was said rather grimly on the first day, strict county championship rules. Now on the third day, the two amateurs, Alf Jeacock and Percy Fender, drove over by car, and they got there in plenty of time, and they're changing in the dressing room when one of the umpires came in and told Percy George Fender there was no sign of his pros, and Percy George knew this perfectly well. This was in the amateurs' dressing room, and Douglas looked up and said, "Strictly county championship rules, Fender." "Of course," said Fender. And duly, just before 11, he and Alf Jeacock went out with a ball and a pair of wicket-keeping gloves, and the two army captains, Sharp and Treglown, who had due out to bat and resume the Essex innings, came out a little reluctantly. "Come on," said Fender, "let's have a game of cricket." He bowled an over and Alf Jeacock kept wicket, and then they changed gloves and Jeacock bowled an over. They both bowled wide of the off stump. Neither batsman ventured a stroke, and they had bowled five overs for no runs. And mark you, this was never entered in the scorebook. It wasn't mentioned in the press, thanks largely to old Perrin going in and asking the press not to say anything about it, but you couldn't get away with it today, could you? And the Surrey coach arrived. Now, see, they couldn't even change in the coach because all their gear was in the dressing room. But a few of them were very nearly nude by the time they jumped out, because what had happened was that the driver had lost his way in that great jungle of bricks and mortar in the East End of London. And the first man on the field was dear old Struddy, Bert Strudwick. Sleeves flapping as had never happened before, flies undone, boots unlaced, socks hanging down. In fact, he was still in his ordinary street socks, and he came dashing out with his gloves under his arm, panting, and he said, "Oh, Mr. Fender, Mr. Fender, any byes?" Dear old Strud, the most faithful of all wicket keepers. Dear little man. And in 1926, when England were coming up to that test match, the final test to take the Ashes for the first time since before the war, they decided to drop Strud and to pick George Brown of Hampshire. Now, you couldn't imagine two men more different than Strud and George, except that they were both dedicated cricketers. Little Strud, so faithful, so quiet, and George Brown, tall and angular and strong, an absolute giant, the only man I've ever seen who could tear a pack of cards across in his bare hands. He walked from Cowley in Oxfordshire, where he came from, with a cricket bag on his shoulders, with all his cricket gear, all his belongings, his clothes and everything else. And he walked from Cowley to Hampshire for a county trial. I said to him one day, What would you have done if they'd rejected you, George? He said, they wouldn't have made a silly mistake like that. And they didn't, and this great man was the supreme all-rounder. Fast bowler, outswing, left-hand bat, reckoned in one of the who's who's before the First World War as the furthest thrower in the game. Reckoned to be the finest silly point there had ever been. Jack Hobbs used to tell the story that once he said, old Alec Kennedy, and he didn't bowl a bad ball once a season. He said, he bowled me a half volley outside the off stump. And I leant on it, said Jack. And Jack said he leant on something. It means it was going like a shell because his timing was so perfect, he said. And I looked to the boundary and so did everybody else. And George Brown said, well, you wouldn't believe that, would you? He said, and he was 2 yards from the bat. He got the ball in the palm of his hand. He said, I looked at him, I couldn't believe it. He said, and he took it off and he said, and look at that, mate. Now, George had had a bruised palm of the hand from a stop in a previous game. He'd been rubbing his hands with oil of wintergreen. And this drive of Jack's hit him plumb in the palm of the hand with such force that the royal coat of arms peeled off on the oil of wintergreen. And he said, now don't disturb this, anybody. I'm going in to lunch with this, with a coat of arms in the palm of my hand. Which he duly did. He was a man of quite phenomenal strength, power, resistance. He looked like a Red Indian chief. And once, I suppose it would be about 1910, 11, 12 perhaps, Hampshire playing Kent at Portsmouth, and Kent got an awful lot of runs. And George Brown, who could bowl a bit quick, bounced them at the Kent bats, and he didn't get any of them out. But he whistled the ball round their ears, and they said, all right, George, all right. You wait till other fielder gets at you. I don't care about fielder, he said. So in due course, he'd made, I think, 70 in the first innings and the second innings. Fielder came out and really let rip at him. And after about a couple of balls, George turned on this short lifting ball, dropped his hands, took it in the middle of the chest and said, you're not even fast, son, and made 50. Now, this is a sequel. 20 years later, Hampshire played Lancashire at Bournemouth, and George, and it was related, you know, in whispers, that George in those days had a terrific rubber spring that used to coil round his chest. And when he pulled his arm fully back, this spring would snap and the rubber would pull his arm round, enable him to bowl extremely fast round arm. And once it's related to a jammed and he had to run off the field with his arm round his own neck. But he bowled very fast indeed at Lancashire, and he said, all right, you wait till Gordon Hodgson gets at you. That's the South African, you remember, the Liverpool soccer player who bowled fast for Lancashire. I don't worry about him, he said. So out they came, and after a few balls, Hodgson dropped one short, and it lifted. George squared up, it hit him on the chest, and he said, he's not. And slowly and breathlessly, he subsided in the crease, and he picked him up and said he'd better go off. I'm not going off, he said, but he only survived 2 more balls before he was out. Out Frank Sibbles, I believe, but what a difference 20 years makes. Bob Wyatt recalled an occasion when Warwickshire played Hampshire at Southampton, and George had been in trouble with Lionel Tennyson. Although he'd been an England opener, he'd done something that upset his lordship, and he was accordingly sent in at number 10. He came out of the dressing room, cap on, gloves in his hand, pads on, but no bat. And he went into the old groundsman's store that used to be at the bottom of the dressing room steps where the secretary's office now is, and he came out with an ancient bat trailing tape and twine and a laughter gradually growing round the ground, and this was his response to an England opener being sent in at number 10. He thumped the first ball straight to mid-off and the bat split with an echoing crack. Now, the larger portion of the blade was not attached to the handle. He tore that off and presented it to the umpire to hold for him. And as Bob Wyatt recalled, proceeded against the Warwickshire fast bowler Harry Howell to make 18 runs with only a third of a bat blade. And he said, if his lordship wants to send me in at number 10, I ain't going to bat with a full bat. He kept wicket for England. He kept wicket for England in 1921 against the Australians because he was one of the few people they knew could play fast bowling, and he was quite fearless. But Walter Livesey was Hampshire's regular wicketkeeper, and after all, he was taken to South Africa in 24-5 as first-choice wicketkeeper. Well, he would have played for England, but he was injured when he first got there and sent back. But George said since he wasn't a regular wicketkeeper, he was going to buy a pair of wicketkeeping gloves. So he used to keep wicket in his motorcycling gauntlets. He used to drive a great big Indian motorbike all round England in the most noisy, frightening, terrifying and hectic fashion. And deciding to take a little practice the day before the test match at the Oval in his motorcycling gauntlets, the protection proved inadequate. The ball broke a finger in his hand and he didn't play in the test match, and Bert Stradwick did. But nothing could take away from George this sort of giant quality. He wasn't terribly well off, George. He wasn't one of those who took much money out of cricket. And he was a car park attendant in Winchester. I can remember going down there with young Ian Craig and a couple more Australians on one occasion just before they were going to play there, and leading them around the back up towards the cathedral car park, and there stood a huge man, and one of them said, "Isn't he wearing an England blazer?" I said, "Yes, he'll have a drink with you in an England blazer." And George came over. He was primed. He knew they were coming. But he was very proud of his England blazer, and he had a series of heart attacks. And every time he went into Winchester Hospital with a heart attack, he insisted on taking the England blazer in which he was going to be buried. But always after about a couple of days, he'd say, "I'm all right now. I'm going out." They said, "Mr. Brown, you can't go." "Well, I'm going. Whether I go in my pyjamas or my trousers is up to you." And he'd pull on the blazer, they'd bring him his trousers, and he'd say, "My little old missus can't do without me, you know." His wife was blind. She was the sweetest of women. And George, that great, tough, strong man, used to look after her as gently as a woman. The last of those heart attacks, there was no doubt it was the last. He was sitting up in the hospital bed like the ghost of a Red Indian chief, and he said rather gruffly, "Don't come and see me any more." "Oh, George." "No, no, boy," he said, "all right, I know you come to be kind. But I can't do with it any more, you see," he said. "When my old missus comes, she can't see me, so it's all right if I pull myself together and have a good shave of me. Face feels smooth," he said, "but I know what I look like. I'm waiting to die and I'm not frightened. But don't come and see me any more. Remember me the way I was." Of the big, hard, strong men, George was one of the gentle ones. George Brown of Hampshire, a very considerable man, and he and old Philip Mead, you know, when the Australians tore into England in 1921, they were the great resistors, the two left-handers. Old Philip, he was pear-shaped with these immensely powerful bowed legs, and he used to toddle out to the wicket. And before every ball he ever received, he went through a specific ritual. He stepped up, took guard if necessary, if it was the first ball, and then he patted the bat gently three times in the crease. He took three little shuffling strides up to the bat and touched his cap three times, though not in respect to the bowler. And if anybody tried to hurry him, and I saw Clary Grimmett once try to hurry him six balls to the over, he just drew back and went through the whole ritual all over again. He used to wear out four caps a season. I think it was six in some of his heavy seasons. And of course his performances were quite prodigious. If you realise, he made more runs for Hampshire than anybody else ever made for any team in the history of cricket. I don't know many statistics, but this I think is staggering. He made 48,892 runs for Hampshire alone. He made 1,000 runs in a season 27 times. Every season he played from 1906 to 1936 with the interruption of the First World War. 10 times over 2,000 runs. And he hated practice. He was like those tribesmen of legend who never drew their knives except to draw blood. And if they didn't kill an enemy, they pricked their fingers to make the blood run. Philip only picked up his bat to make runs, business runs. And once he got a century, first match of the season, when he came in, Alec Kennedy said, "Well played, Philip." "No, it wasn't," he said. "Don't be damn silly. Never timed a ball decently from start to finish." So Alec said, "All right, Philip, when did you last have a bat in your hands?" He said, "Last Scarborough Festival." And he used to say to the youngsters, "You lead in May, I shall catch you in June." Once in June, I believe I'm right in saying he made 1,600 runs in 13 innings. Certainly in one game against Warwickshire. When Hampshire followed on, he batted for a day and a half, and when he came in, not out at the end, he said, "I was just getting used to it." Writing a history of Hampshire cricket, talking to Alec Kennedy one day, an old member came up and pushed his five eggs in. "Oh," he said, "I know what you're talking about." He said, "You're talking about Mead, you two." So we admitted we were. "Oh," he said, "I know, made a lot of runs." He said, "But it was so slow, wasn't he?" He said, "I remember one day here against Notts," he said. "We lost a couple of early wickets, so it can't have been much after 10 to 12 when he came in," he said. "And he stonewalled all day till half past five for 232. Philip, he never seemed to hurry. He used to say, if he saw you at practice, about in the ball, no, no, no. Hard enough for fours, hard enough." He took a terrific number of catches, I think 600 or 700 in his career, and he fielded slip. But he much resented running. And he had a bit of a thing with Jack Newman. He used to suddenly bowl his faster ball when Philip, who was a solitary slip, wasn't looking. Jack was an off-spinner. And once it took the edge of the bat and hit Philip straight between the eyes and stunned him. And for a fortnight he stood wide at slip and let it pass between him and the wicketkeeper to teach Jack Newman not to bowl his quicker one without warning him. And dear old Jack, I remember him saying once, "You don't want to bowl off break, son. Come and look at this." Followed him round, and there in those iron railings in front of the Southampton Pavilion, he said, "See those dents?" "Yes, Jack." "All done by chaps nicking my quicker one when Philip wasn't looking." Some people do make, you know, such a vivid impression on you. In 1928, going down to see West Indies at Southampton, Leary Constantine was building out the covers when Lionel Tennyson was really going, and he ran at full tilt, ran over the ball at right angles to its course and picked it up between his legs and threw it in. Many years later, fielding substitute, third man at Worcester, Pataudy got 200. "I'll give you a bit of exercise," he said. "You spend too much time in deck chairs. So, if the captain waved third man square, Pataudy cut five. If he put him five, Pataudy played square. He got 200 easily, smoothly, lovely innings." He hit one at the Pavilion Gate at Worcester, and of course that ground used to flood badly, still does sometimes, not so badly as it did. And waterweed used to grow there. You should never field in crepe-soled boots. If you do, you pay the penalty. So, running like mad, sudden realisation, never get round this, never square up. Now, how it should enter the mind of a bulky and clumsy a character as me to do a Constantine, run over it and pick it up and throw it in, I shall never know. I ran over it, I got my hand down to it, and I picked it up, and then the old crepe soles started to slide. Again, how I can have imagined that I could turn a complete somersault, holding the ball, land on my shoulder blades and come up, I don't know, but I did. I shut my eyes. I got to my feet, I pulled my arm back, I opened my eyes, and the Worcestershire members were opening like the Red Sea before the children of Israel, because I was about to throw the ball through the pavilion windows. I turned not only over, but round as well. And when I turned round, Neil McCorker was sitting down laughing, and Len Crease was sobbing with laughter. Oh, they got three overthrows, so I threw it over the top of the wicketkeeper. So, you know, every man should know what he can compass and what he can't, and this is the influence of the great, that they tempt some of us to attempt things that we cannot achieve. It isn't often that a great man leaps into your life, but in 1946, the commentary was being done from a box at Old Trafford, which had been damaged during the war by bombing and was approachable only by a rather lopsided and limp and semi-fractured staircase which had lost three of its four handrails and was protected on only one side. The commentators were standing there in the morning before play began, discussing what they would do, and all of a sudden, a tall figure flew into their presence, one hand on the handrail. He'd vaulted from the wall at the back, and it was Charles Fry, Charles Burgess Fry, C.B. Fry, at the age of 74, who had leapt into the deliberations. Once somebody said to him, "Good morning, Charles," he said, "Captain Fry to you, sir." So one always hesitates to call him Charlie. He did that behind his back, but Charles Fry was a most incredible man. He had dominated sport at Repton, 4 years in the cricket team, captain for two, captain of soccer, individual athletics winner in 2 years. He'd won Oxford Blues for cricket, association football and athletics. He missed a rugby blue only by an injury in a match before the university match, and he was only doing that for fun anyway. He came down to Iffley Road. He went into the groundsman's hut from a very good lunch, produced a flask and poured himself a whisky and lit a cigar, put down the cigar, went out and set a world record for the long jump, walked back in, and he only jumped once. He had scored a century for Oxford against Cambridge, gentlemen against players, and England against Australia. He had played at full back because the only amateur in a full England soccer side. He was the only amateur in the Southampton side that went to the cup final, and he was a pillar of the Corinthians for over 20 years. He was a brilliant classical scholar. He was head of the Wadham scholarship list, ahead of F.E. Smith, Lord Birkenhead, and all others. He had edited a popular magazine, written and published a novel, all before he was 30. He recreated the training ship Mercury on Hamble River that gave the Navy and the Merchant Navy a whole succession of extremely well-trained sailors. He had a superb mind. He won the Poetry Prize at Oxford. He was incredibly witty, a first-class speaker and broadcaster. He could write a learned treatise, and he could write for the popular press, and he wrote a fine autobiography called Life Worth Living, and my word, he couldn't have picked a better nor more apt title than that. He was top of the first-class batting averages, I would think, four or five times. The last time in 1912, and he must have been 40. He captained England that season to beat Australia and South Africa in the first and only triangular tournament ever held. And in, as late as 1921, when England were in such dire trouble, when he was 49 years old, and only playing just occasionally for Hampshire. He started with Surrey, gone to Sussex, then to Hampshire. The selectors asked him to captain the England side, and he would have done, but that he suffered a hand injury trying to get some practice two matches earlier. He had the features of a Greek god, an aquiline nose, an imperious look, wavy fair hair, impeccable manners, wide shoulders, superbly shaped body, and a sense of humour and of dignity that never failed him. He was a representative twice at the League of Nations deliberations. He was offered and refused the throne of Albania. And he used to discuss, you know, what would have happened if he had accepted the throne of Albania. Well, of course, he said, the Italian invasion would never have happened, you know. He said, you see, it would have been ideal, the end of March, for English cricket teams to come out in that favourable climate and get some practice in the sun before the county season began. And of course I'd have had pitches there for them, they'd have come out. And damn it, nobody would have dared to invade Albania with county cricket going on there. But the British Navy would have been absolutely obliged to step in and prevent it. Might have stopped Mussolini, he said, so perhaps I ought to have accepted it, but I must say at the time it seemed to me a damn bore. This was a most remarkable man. Great? I wonder. He was an admirable Crichton. I wonder if there was anything at which he was ultimately great, or if, and this may be true, that he was the most talented and versatile and gifted human being who could ever live a full life with it. There are no rules about genius, are there? Jack Hobbs, you see, was a great man. I think never realised he was a great man. When he got his letter, the Prime Minister is pleased to inform you that he was going to be offered a knighthood. He was really distressed. So he went to see Lord Monckton. And he said, "Sir, I wonder if you could stop all this nonsense, because it's very difficult. It makes me blush." So Lord Monckton concealed his mirth and convinced Jack that This was an honour not only to Jack, but to all professional cricketers. He was, of course, the first professional cricketer to be knighted, and he accepted it with natural grace, and he wore a knighthood with the dignity of a prince. And so modest about it, he used to tell the story of the young journalist in Cambridge, because all the talk was, you know, why Jack had never got 200 centuries. He said, but this had never worried him. It's my friends. I just wish I'd got it from my friends. I didn't realise how disappointed they were. There was this boy, apparently, who followed him round. He was on the local paper. He was desperately anxious for Jack to get his first century, and Jack was out LBW for 96. Was it a bad decision, Jack? And he wasn't a man to carp about decisions. Well, he said it wasn't very good. He would have missed another set of stumps. So when Jack came off, grinning as usual, because he always thought cricket was a game, it was one of the reasons he was such a great player, the boy said, Jack, you weren't out, you weren't out. I'm not going to have it. I'm not going to have it. He said, well, you've got to have it. I've got it. And he said, you wait till you see the paper. So Jack said, well, you can't give me 100. But surely enough, he ordered the paper, Jack Hobbs, not out 96, and posted a copy to the umpire. Jack and Arthur Mailey used to laugh. Twice in test matches, Arthur bowled Jack with full tosses, and he said once, always wanted to get him on a dusty wicket to see how he could play. First time I ever did, he said, I talked myself on as soon as I could before anybody else could get him out. And the first ball I bowled him in, I dropped a leg break, middle and leg, and it must have turned more than a foot to outside the off stump, he said, and he walked across outside the off stump, and he hit me to square leg for four, and he said in that funny little squeaky voice of his, poor old Arthur, they always put you on where the ball won't turn. And if you can do this as a joke, you're a great player. When Charlie Parker died, I rang up Jack and said, morning, Jack. He said, morning. I know what you're ringing about. What, Charlie's? And I said, yeah. Yes, he said, poor old Charlie, what a good player. Would it be true to say, Jack, that of all the slow left-arm bowlers, he spun the ball more than anyone except perhaps Frank Ryan? Well, he said, nobody spun it much more than he did, but I'm not going to call him really slow, he said, because he was so much like this chap Underwood. He didn't give much air. He didn't invite you, like some of them did. I said, how did he take punishment, Jack? Well, not very well, he said. Of course, you see, he was such a good bowler, he said. And they always seemed to get us on turners, especially at Cheltenham. He said, well, Charlie had come on. And he'd take one look at what he was doing, he said, and he was taking a divot, and the ball was lifting and turning. He said, well, there's only one thing to do, he said. You hit him over the top of mid-off, an extra cover, for half a dozen fours in a couple of overs, and he didn't want to bowl. So a few weeks later, I related this to Tom Goddard, and old Tom's brow went black as thunder. That's true, he said, that's true. Charlie couldn't take it, he said. And old Albert used to knock him over the top of extra cover and mid-off, and we'd say, don't take any notice, Charlie. He said, what do you mean, don't take any notice? There goes another one. He said, and he'd go out to third man. And Jack Hobbs had settled down, grinning all over his face, and make another 100. And this, you know, is the tribute of the pro to the pro, the tribute to excellence. It had a rich sense of fun, Jack. He was a wonderful pocket picker, and he'd give you back all your possessions when you left him. Say, is this your fountain pen? He said, oh, heavens, yes. Where'd that come from? Oh, it was on the table. And then he produced your wallet and your diary, and you realised he gently picked your pocket while lunch was going on. He used to have a great trick at the Oval. If somebody was just round the corner of the dressing room where they couldn't see the play, he'd get the others all together, and all of a sudden he'd say, he's out, he's out. Good luck, Jim. And the batsman, you know, pick up his bat and gloves in a hurry. Sent Jack Newman off once in a gentleman players match at the Oval. In the middle of Jack's benefit season, he was writing letters like mad. He's out, and Jack grabbed his bat and his gloves, and he came out of the darkness and blinked and down the steps. And he was two-thirds of the way down the oval steps before he heard the others laughing and looked out and saw the match was in full progress, and Jack had done him again. And he used to do Percy Chapman, who was a fairly bibulous character, and who used to collect two extra double gin and tonics at lunch at Lord's and put them in a ginger beer bottle and stow it in his bag to drink at tea time. If Jack could get off the field, he would empty this and fill it with water. And on one occasion, Percy came in. It was a blazing hot day. opened his bag, took out the ginger beer bottle and the cork, and of course everybody in the side was wise to what had happened. He put it up to his lips with a beatific smile, poured it down, the expression on his face changed, he said, "That bloody Hobbs!" And Jack, of course, had disappeared. He was a man of infinite fun and of infinite kindness. I don't think a young cricketer ever went to him for help, guidance, or even an autograph without being satisfied. He was the kindest, gentlest, most generous of men. I suppose if you were looking for a modern successor to Jack Hobbs, you'd have to say it was Len Hutton. He had that same immense sympathy with the bold ball. He knew what it was going to do. He felt it. You never saw Len play a violent shot, nor one which contradicted the flow of the game. He was a splendidly shrewd captain, a handsome batsman. If you realise that he made good that awful loss of reach on one arm and to master everything that came his way, you realise just how extremely good he was. And he had, of course, his wonderful sense of humour. After he'd left the game and was reporting, he was watching a West Indies side in which the first two batsmen were competing for the one place for an opener left for the Test side. They got in a terrible mess. They both got in the 90s. Neither wanted the other one to get his 100, and eventually one was run out when he charged down the other end, found his partner standing with his back towards him, looking the other way, and very nearly got back and made his ground and was out. And Leonard turned to somebody next to him in the press box and he said, "Aye. And they want self-government." It's a pure Hutton remark. And once talking to him about what he might do about team selection when he first became captain, would he agree that the essential was to pick batsmen who were capable against not just ordinary fast medium but high pace, that the only way to beat Australia was to have batsmen who could play high pace? Aye, that's right. Who can? You can, Leonard. Aye. Dennis Compton. Aye. Trevor Bailey. Aye, but not going in first. No. Trevor Bailey. Aye. Jack Aitken. How do we know? Well, you know, against Gowan McCarthy at Old Trafford on that ugly wicket when he was bouncing him over the nut and into the ribs and making him lift. And Jack never flinched, did he? No, he didn't. Didn't play him like a great batsman, did he? Don't know, Len. How would a great batsman have played him? He'd have been down to the end. And Leonard was! That was a great crop, you know, that came up to the Hutton win of 53, the conclusive one of 56. It's very hard to make superlatives, to say so-and-so was the best there has ever been of this, but I think there is no doubt that Jim Laker is the greatest off-spinner there ever was. Word came back, you know, from North Africa during the war that there was an off-spinner out there bowling in Cairo, and down at the non-striker's end you heard the ball buzz as it left his fingers. He came back and Yorkshire didn't want him back. They just thought of him as the young batsman from Saltaire. And he went to play this Surrey trial. You see, he was pitched into a test match against Australia when he'd hardly played a full season's cricket. He learnt so fast. He is the only one to my mind who had everything, a sense of tactics and a feeling for strategy. Do you realise that he would bowl an over and never take the same number of steps up to the wicket nor the same length? So the batsman was constantly thinking he was going to bowl before he did. He could make this floater go and a swinger go and hold one and let it roll with the arm as well as the off break. And of course that great feat at Old Trafford was not performed on a sticky wicket. And I don't care what anybody says, it was not performed on a sticky wicket. It turned a bit at times, and at times it lifted. But you've got to realise that Colin McDonald played a long, tough, durable innings there. And Lockie was at the other end, and Lockie only got one wicket. Mind, I'll grant you that that was freakish. But that performance of Laker's, which I suppose is the one statistical performance in cricket that will never be beaten, was a performance of a man of immense skill. You see, it is not a game for the untutored. It's a game of the greatest profundity, of incredible profundity, and unless you're going to include chess, the deepest game in the world. And I think this has been shown in recent years by the immense improvement in captaincy, first Hutton, then Illingworth, and then Brearley. You've brought to captaincy a a dimension that people had not hitherto perceived. And under it, other players have flourished. You can work it out for as long as ever you like, but there was an ingredient in Botham's achievement that lent, at least in his early days, on Brearley, and perhaps for a few more days than anybody had actually realised. The other thing one may feel is that the game is indigenous to England. Now, that's not quite true, but it is certainly true that English cricket is a game apart. But then, you see, so is Australian cricket, so is Indian cricket, so is New Zealand cricket, West Indian cricket, and even Pakistani cricket, which is completely different from Indian cricket. This is a game of such a source and depth that a national character and people's character is reflected in it. All right, your 11 footballers play their afternoon game and they go away, and they've left an impression upon your skill of effect or violence or strength or something. But you never see them as human beings. You never perceive their character. Now, the cricketer is showing you his character all the time. The time since that test match in 1926 through to 1980 seems, in retrospect, an incredible richness, a wealth of excitement, of characters and people. And of course, those you knew and saw first are the most vivid in the memory and the most satisfying in the heart. If you're a little Hampshire boy, of course, if you're a little Yorkshire boy, a Leicestershire boy, a Sussex boy, a Kent boy, somehow following the cricket of that county created in your mind a mythology of that particular county. And once you've done that, it stays with you always. In fact, once a cricketer, whether you're a good player, an indifferent player, a bad player, or not a player at all, you're a cricketer in the heart always. And it was an old man, player of many years before, sitting on the bench at Sherborne St. John, that prompted these few lines on the old cricketer. He sits alone to watch the men at cricket on the village green, and savours calmly once again the life-remembered quiet scene that to his ageing sight grows dim. But then he sees with clearer eye these men's fathers play with him, their fathers' fathers standing by. He leaps once more with eager spring to catch the brief glimpsed flying ball, and quickens to its sudden sting. The brightness dies, the old eyes fall. They see but do not understand a pursed, rheumatic, useless hand.